And from Kentucky Speedway, we send our congratulations to Kevin Harvick and invite you to stay tuned because we're going to crank up the speed. We're going to go over 218 miles an hour at this mile and a half oval, and the fans are filing in for their seats as we're getting ready to go green here in Kentucky. Sometimes, drama is defined by a moment in time where danger becomes a reality. And for the IndyCar series last week, time stood still. Points leader Dario Franchitti walked away from the damage of the drama.
Dario's car got airborne.
When I stopped and I realized I was in one piece, I still can't believe it.
Then teammate Danica Patrick stared victory in the face only to find the disappointment of defeat.
Couldn't believe it.
Today is a new day at a new place. A place rich in racing tradition. Four races remain, two ovals, two road courses, and one championship. The drama continues tonight in Kentucky. And we welcome you to Kentucky Speedway, where the thousands of fans here are sweating all day, but the sun is beginning to set. It's going to cool off just a touch as we're getting ready to go green here at the Optima Batteries IndyCar 300, presented by GoDaddyCop.com at Kentucky Speedway. And it's been a big weekend so far for everybody. In fact, Dario Franchitti, you see the bruise on his nose? More on that in a second. That's his only injury from last week's crash. Tony Kanaan will start from pole tonight. And there is Sam Hornish, the man who won here last year. We welcome you to Firestone Race Day, where we'll go back up 1 week ago to all the carnage and the results of what happened at Michigan, and also set the scene for what will unfold in the next 2 hours. Of course, it has all been about Dario Franchitti. Who can forget, if you've seen the video, how miraculously it was that he came out of this with nothing more than a bruise on his nose.
Dario Franchitti stalled. He has fallen to the back of the field.
Dario Franchitti riding it for all he can.
Here comes Franchitti. He is really on a rip.
Mike, that was the drama of the year. That was magic.
Whoa!
Oh, it's big crash. All kinds of debris in the back straightaway.
Dario's car got airborne. It appears as though he is going to be able to climb out of the race car.
Dario Franchitti, he's done a lot of interviews this week, people wanting to talk about that incident last week in Michigan. You just watched it. What goes through your mind? What do you pick out when you see the replay of that incident?
Actually, I didn't watch it. I closed my eyes at that bit. I've watched it enough to... I'm just thankful everybody's okay. That's the first thing. I'm still a little bit angry about how it happened. But otherwise, you know, just thankful I'm here and ready to fight again in Kentucky.
How do you keep an incident of that nature from affecting your mindset when you get in the car today?
You just got to be strong mentally, I guess. You know, I went out in the first practice yesterday, and we were quickest, and we were running wheel to wheel with everybody out there, even Dan. So it doesn't seem to have affected us, and I'll just be keeping my head down.
Will you show us the bruise on your nose? What caused that?
It's fading. Because I kind of got a large nose, it's not as big as TK's, but it's still pretty large. When the roll hook broke and the helmet contacted the tarmac, it pushed the visor opening down into my nose, so that's how it all happened.
Bruised nose, but it hasn't slowed him down. He starts second today. Marty?
All right, thanks, Vince. As you see, there's the number 27. He'll be on the outside of the front row tonight, right alongside his Andretti Green teammate. Take a look at the championship point standings. It's Dario. He went into Michigan with a 24-point lead over Scott Dixon. He came out with a 24-point lead. But Tony Kanaan has cut it to 81 markers, back to third. He still has an outside chance at this championship. Now, let's go back, bring in Scott Goodyear here, because last week we were all amazed at what happened. And really what was lost in it all was this great drive that Dario put after having the problems in pit lane.
You know, he really has had a lucky season so far. Last year he wasn't so lucky. Looked like he had a shot at the points title, and that didn't work out for him. This year he said just a few races ago, I'm not sure what it is, but we have been lucky. This stall here in pit lane, well, he got back out, was at the very back of the grid and worked his way through, which was a championship-type drive, and got himself back up to the front. But in this situation here, connecting with Dan Weldon, his luck ran out, Marty.
and he did that run back to the front in six laps. Now, Ryan Barnhart in the driver's meeting today, we've seen him up on the tire, so to speak, but not like today.
Well, and I think rightly so. You know, in all the years of driving and then attending the meetings now as a with the television group, I have to tell you that I've never seen Brian like this, and I'm glad that he said what he said. You are all on probation from this point forward for the way that you drove at Michigan. If anybody puts a wheel wrong, you're going to come into the pit lane and answer for it. And I think that's what they needed to hear if they're going to go out there and drive with respect, because I don't think they respected each other, and I think they lost sight that they're going over the length of a football field in less than a second out there just competing their daily job.
Total of 12 cars crashed last week, but luckily everybody came out of it okay. Let's go to Jack Root, and he can explain one of the reasons why.
Well, for Dario Franchitti in particular, take a look at our target cutaway car. We've positioned the driver the way Dario Franchitti and all the IndyCar drivers are, and you notice where their head is located as applied to the back end where the air intake is. Well, behind this carbon fiber shell, which, by the way, is one of the probably one of the most strongest materials in the world, is a 1-inch metal roll hoop. Now, that roll hoop is securely attached to the carbon fiber tub, and it creates a triangle of safety, which is what caused Dario Franchitti to be in a margin of safety. Here you see Franchitti going up and over, hitting that roll hoop, shearing it off. But the end result was that Dario Franchitti was able to walk away. Why? Because of that triangular roll hoop. And by the way, guys, they still haven't found the roll hoop because it was eventually sheared off.
And the postscript to that, that car was the winning car back at the Indianapolis 500. And let's talk about the other guys. I mean, Scott Dixon came out of this okay. I mean, the car landed right on top of him. And then A.J. Foyt the fourth had tire marks all over his helmet.
Oh, wait, Jack has explained everything about the race cars, but the helmet manufacturers, the Hans device manufacturers, seatbelt manufacturers, everybody's done a wonderful job, led by the Indianapolis Motor Speedway and the Indy Racing League. And don't forget, they're also the ones that actually invented the safer barrier. So kudos to everybody here at the Indy Racing League.
Well, let's hear from the man who was also involved, second in the points, Scott Dixon. He's with Brianne Pettigo.
Thanks, Marty. Well, Scott Dixon, step back to Michigan with me just for 1 second. Let's set the scene for the one person out there in the world that didn't see the incident last week. Lap 144, you see Dario Franchitti and Dan Weldon, your teammate, get together in what should have given you the points lead. But then seconds later, you've got a car flying backwards towards your head. From the moment you see those cars get together, what goes through your head?
It's just tough. I think, you know, through the whole race, it was so on edge. We didn't get any green flag stops, and I think that's why we had such a big pack, of just about everybody in one group. So it was really hard trying to figure out. I'd actually started moving up to the high line and trying to get out of the mix of it. And I saw it happen, and then all of a sudden there was a car landing on top of me, so I wasn't in the best position, but I think all of us are just happy that everybody walked away from it with no major problems, just some a few broken cars, and unfortunately it could have been a good race for us for the points, but it didn't work out that way, and we'll just have to move on to this one and see what we can do.
And the ultimate survivor from Michigan is with our very own Vince Welch.
Thank you, Brianne. Tony Kanaan, 81 points behind Dario Franchitti in the championship chase with four races to go, so he's got to make up an average of 20 points per race. You took Dario to dinner last night. Maybe we're going to see some fruits of that labor here today. What do you have to do? Take them one at a time, but what do you have to do here today to have a chance at the championship?
Win. I think, that's the mentality for us. It's going to be hard for us to catch Dario and Dixon. I think the best thing I can do is try to win many races as I can, and if they drop out, that's the only way we're gonna get it.
He won last week at Michigan. He starts from the pole today. Tony Kanaan.
All right, thanks, Vince. The fans are in the stands. We're getting cranked up. Thank you for watching Firestone Race Day. When we come back, it'll be time to light the engines and go racing here at Kentucky Speedway. There's Sam Hornish. He won here twice, including last year.
Sun shines bright on our old Kentucky home, and the young folks lay on the floor. Oh, the sun shines bright on my old Kentucky home, keeping bad times away from my door.
Speed. Speedway. The fans continue to file in. In fact, they're a late arriving crowd. They've been trying to get in. In fact, we're waiting for the command to start engines. But while we've got a moment, Dario Franchitti, there he is down on the grid. He'll start on the outside of the front row. You see his wife Ashley at the back of the car. She was not at Michigan last week. And he basically said she didn't see the crash at first. She actually came into the room when he was out of the car and okay. So when she saw the crash, it didn't frighten her as much. And he said he was thankful for that. We also talked to him earlier this week about the fault involved and the fact of, as you heard Scott and Brian Barnhart mention earlier, the lack of respect out on the track.
When, you know, two of the most experienced drivers in the series end up crashing on the straight, it's just bloody stupid, really. And like I say, in my opinion, you know, Dan made a mistake trying to run closely. I don't know if he was trying to get a side draft or what, but I wasn't impressed, and I want to see the league do something about it. And if they don't, then I've got to ask myself some pretty serious questions.
And Marty, I think what he's really basically there is calling out Dan Weldon in that situation, because Dan sort of got up to him. But you know something? I think the respect has to come from the drivers, and the team owners have to put pressures on those drivers to make sure that they're not out there wrecking equipment and putting lives at risk, because really that's what they're doing when they're sitting in the car here at this time.
Well, we're going to see what happens. I mean, we told you they're going to be running at over 218 miles an hour out here, but it's time to find out just what will unfold. Let's go trackside for the command to start engines.
Race fans, it's time for those most famous words in motorsports. Will you please welcome the Star Bridge of Terabithia and Firehouse Dog, Josh Hutcherson, to give that command.
Drivers, start your engines!
Job by Josh, and the engines have come to life, and the game faces are on, as you can tell. Let's take a look at the 1.5-mile layout here at Kentucky Speedway.
Just 30 minutes south of Cincinnati, Ohio, in Sparta, Kentucky. This track has been a favorite from all the drivers since it opened up here in 2000. Four turns, both turns on each end seem to be about very similar to all the drivers. The banking here on the front and back stretch is just a little different. Front stretch 8 degrees, back is about 4, and the banking in turns 14 degrees. Just enough to keep these speeds up to about 215, 16 miles an hour going around here. Drivers love to run this track flat out. It has turned out to be a little bit bumpy. Now we're going to take a lap here with Sam Hornish Jr. and watch the Firestone telemetry on the right-hand side. The speed climbs up through turns 1 and 2 where we are right now. 100% throttle all the way around here. That's what the drivers will be trying to achieve throughout this race. No braking taken into account on this lap, with the exception of maybe coming up to traffic. And the least amount of steering that you can put into this race car around here, the more neutral it is, the faster the car will go. And geez, up around 4.0 all the time in the turns, Marty.
And you can see just how fast we can fly around Kentucky Speedway. All right, let's take a look at our starting grid. It'll come across the top of your screen. We've already talked about the front row being Andretti Green with Tony Kanaan and Dario Franchitti side by side. But for the second week in a row, a strong qualifying performance by that man right there, Scott Sharp.
Scott Sharp just in row two. Remember, he won here last in 2005, the last time a team other than Andretti Green, Penske, or Chip Ganassi has won an event in IndyCar racing. Ryan Hunter-Reay, a great run by him also. In row five, Carpenter and Ford. The Vision team has been doing very well here this weekend, Marty.
Well, but the one guy who is not doing real well right there, Elio Castroneves, 13th. You can see where he is. And, of course, that's a good note. He won 2002 Indy 500 after starting 13th. But this is the lowest that he has been in 32 races.
He didn't seem to be fazed by it. He says, we've taken all the information from Sam's car, put it in our car. We think we will have a better race car today than we had for a qualifying car yesterday.
All right, let's get some final updates from pit lane. Let's bring in Brianne Pettigo first.
Thanks, Marty. While there's still a little bit of frustration from Danica Patrick over what could have been a potential first win at Michigan in the Andretti Motorola camp down here, there is also optimism. Kim Green has said that Danica has proven now to everyone that she is capable of winning in the IndyCar Series. Not only does she have the skill, the equipment, and the team to support her, all they're waiting for now is all of those pieces to come together in what this team believes is an inevitable win. Vince Welch.
Well, Scott Goodyear addressed Scott Sharp's significant win here in 2005. And I asked Scott yesterday after qualifying, in which he had the third fastest speed, can you do it again? And he said, yes, I believe we can. And what a huge boost that would be for this Patron Ray Hall Letterman team. But he said, we must stay with the lead pack, and we must use the draft to our advantage, something all these front runners are going to do. And certainly it helps to be able to start in that third position, Jackaroo.
Well, Vince, normally if you qualify in the third row, you would be extremely ecstatic, but not the case for Target Chip Ganassi and their owner, Chip Ganassi. Extremely displeased with the performance of his driver, Dan Weldon. Not so as well, also displeased by the performance of Scott Dixon. Why? Not because of anything that the drivers have done, but because they came here and tested, and I quote Chip, we were fast, so fast no one could catch us. He said, the next thing I know, we go to Michigan, and we're not fast. We come here, we're not fast as well. He said, we'll just have to wait and see what happens.
All right, the lights are out on the pace car. They're into turn three for the final time before we drop the hammer and go racing here at Kentucky Speedway. The Optima Batteries IndyCar 300 is green. Getting ready to complete.
Hold your line. On your car. Clear.
And as we come to the stripe to complete lap number one, it's Tony Kanaan followed by his teammate Dario Franchitti. You're on board with Dario.
Boy, Tony really wasted no time to put his foot on the gas on that start. Said, I want to go out there and win the race because I might have a chance at the championship, but if it gets down to the end, then I'll take care of my wingman and help him, being Dario Franchitti, win the championship. But today, it's all about him trying to win this race, Marty.
Good battle for third. There's Scott Dixon as they come across to complete lap number two. It'll be Dixon moving ahead of Scott Sharp to take third, but he's still right there on the low line. Then back in fifth, it's Sam Horner. Sixth is Dan Weldon. Seventh is Ed Carpenter as he moves up. Thomas Schechter, eighth. Danica Patrick's up to ninth. A.J. Foyt, the fourth. Fourth is 10th. That rounds out your top 10 on board with Danica.
Yeah, she's moved up a couple of spots from her starting position. She was so frustrated after qualifying yesterday. She had the same setup as Tony Kanaan and Dario Franchitti for qualifying. Couldn't get the speed out of the car. Marco Andretti had the same thing. But you know something? The frustration just shows that she's very serious, very emotional about trying to get her first win in IndyCars.
Well, while she continues back there, I'm noticing that Sam Hornish Jr. is on the move. There's Danica trying to close on Ed Carpenter. That would be for eighth. Complete lap number four. She's got the low line but can't seem to close. We managed to eavesdrop on the radio and a little bit of a pre-race pep talk. Let's listen in.
Hello, everybody. I hope have a good day. I'll try and hit my mark straight for you guys, make it better, and we'll be fast and we'll get to the front.
I like that plan. You are going to now lead the strategy meeting from now on.
So there is the exchange between the team, and let's check in with Sam Hornish Jr. We've got an onboard with him today, and he has moved from his seventh starting position up to fourth.
Said yesterday, just disappointed with qualifying. Remember, he's won here before. He's always been very fast. The home of his first IndyCar race back in 2000, of which he'd led laps and really put his name on the mark in the IndyCar series, running for a smaller team, but really went out there and showed everybody what he was capable of, and certainly has flourished ever since that point. But yesterday, disappointed because he wasn't on the front row, but he still had the big picture in mind, which is winning this race and getting more points towards helping himself climb in the championship.
Well, when he won this race in 03, he led 181 of 200 laps, and of course, last year he led 57, winning that event as well. Meanwhile, the battle up front, not really a battle, more like the two teammates running in lockstep, trying to get some distance between everybody else. Let's get an update from pit lane, Jackaroo.
Well, Marty, that's one of the reasons why they're doing the two tango there, but also another reason why Dario Franchitti is not challenging his teammate Tony Kanaan is Dario Franchitti is probably one of the best at conserving fuel. And talking to a lot of these teams, race will be a four-stop race, but that final pit stop, the difference may be how short you can fill. So I think that in the case of Ando Anderson, who calls the shots for Dario Franchitti, he's always told me Franchitti knows how to make fuel. And I asked him right now, is that what he's doing? And he said, we're just laying back.
Well, it makes sense here in the early go. I mean, especially after what happened last week, there's no sense in rushing to the front.
Well, it's neat also to see that they're running, giving themselves a bit of a gap, and he's using the high line, or what we'll call the middle line right now. They try to run three lines around here. The low line is certainly the fastest way around. As you work yourself up, and you can see where Dario Franchitti is running just a little bit further above Tony Kanaan's line, it becomes a little bumpier there. When they first built this track back in 2000, it was as smooth as a billiard table. You can see the hands right now of Dario Franchitti sort of moving around a little bit. There's bumps going down the backstretch, and you try to make a third line here like Tony Kanaan did the other day, and the car almost went out from underneath them. Now, one of the big things around here that I've always been watching for just in the practice to see what kind of car you can have to run up top. There's not many, Marty, that can run that third line. So to win this race, I guess you're going to have to do it in the first or second lane, and people like to protect those lanes. It's going to be interesting to see what happens down to the run to the checkered flag.
Two guys that are the fastest right now on the racetrack, Weldon in fifth. He's closing on Sam Hornish in fourth, both of them lapping at 214, and they are closing quickly on Scott Dixon. So the battle should be tightening up here soon.
Now remember, this race is run at a different time than we've run before, starting at the time frame that we are now, and it's just starting to cool off a little bit. The track will change somewhat. Conditions will become cooler, so the track should get a little bit more grip for you. Teams will be working with their cars to try to continue chasing the track conditions as we run up into 8:30. Now, as the guys are starting to get close to each other, also reporting back what the car is doing, trying to make some changes during the pit stops to chase those track conditions.
Take a look out from behind Sam Hornish, looking back to fifth place, Dan Weldon. Meanwhile, nothing changing up front. The Andretti Green teammates content to run 1-2. There's Scott Dixon in third. Let's get more from pit lane. Vince Welch.
Sam Hornish communicating with team owner Roger Penske on the radio. Penske updating Hornish on his times in relation to the leaders, and also Dan Weldon, who's coming up strong from behind. Hornish complaining that the car's a little bit looser than he'd like it. The owner, Roger Penske, reminding him to work his tools to make that car a little more comfortable.
Great information, Vince, and a loose race car means the back end wants to come around on you, wants to step out, as we like to call it, and maybe that's the reason why he's not getting too close to the back end of Scott Dixon. He's looking for a little bit of clean air, but still has to play protection off his place and his line to the car coming up from behind him, Dan Weldon.
So as these three continue, it is Tony Kanaan, Dario Franchitti, and Scott Dixon. It's the 10th race Kanaan has led this year. He has three wins. That ties him with guess who? The man that's right behind him, Dario Franchitti, and the guy who's third, Scott Dixon.
Danica Patrick wants to go three wide. She and Marco a little higher at the exit of four.
Danica Patrick, 18 hundredths of a second behind leader.
Danica, we're going to ride rear tire, guys. Yeah, but that's a pin. I'm sorry.
Yeah, that's all right. I thought it was my day off. I just want this weight off my shoulder.
The disappointment from last week, she's battling for ninth right now with A.J. Foyt, the fourth. She really thought she could do it. She did have the fastest race lap, and it was late in the race at 2:18.
And she really did a great job playing the race out. Remember, 400 miles last week, and the longest race other than the Indianapolis 500, so a lot of stamina and a lot of mental pressure on a driver, especially going those speeds and one looking for the first win, Marty.
Brianne, you've got more on Danica?
Marty, while Danica Patrick and A.J. Foyt, the fourth, battle it out for position on the track, they're losing fuel and also losing distance between them and the leaders. They have advised her that if she does not have the sheer speed to pass Foyt, she should fall in line behind him to save fuel and ultimately gain position on the track.
Well, and closing quickly up behind them is Elio Castroneves. He started 13th. He's up to 11th, trying to get around those two. And let's get an update on Elio's situation from Vince Welch.
I spoke with team engineer Ron Rozewski just before the race got underway today, and he said they made significant changes to Elio's car. Elio was very disappointed with his 13th place qualifying position yesterday, and they changed the Honda motor before qualifying. It didn't seem to help. So they made some significant chassis changes prior to the race today, and you see Elio biding his time there behind that battle between Foyt and Danica.
Well, I'm wondering if he's biding his time or he just can't get the horsepower to catch up.
As a race car driver, when you're that back and the front pack is starting to drive off and you would pass those folks in front if you could. So I got to think that he's working with the race car right now with the tools inside, the weight jacker and the roll bars to adjust his suspension. To watch both the Ganassi cars right now starting to run front to rear. And I think that for Elio, he'll be communicating a lot with the engineering group and trying to improve that car on the next stop.
That's Dan Weldon getting around his teammate Scott Dixon.
One to Thomas.
That's Dixon's radio. Let's get an update on Team Target Ganassi from Jackaroo.
Well, both cars, there's no reports of any problems or any issues. But for Dan Weldon, seeing that red and white car from Team Penske get by his teammate was like taking the whip to the rear flank of the 10 car. He had been just riding, and all of a sudden, and we all know the way Dan Weldon looks at things, he doesn't like to see that sandwich have a Team Penske car between him and the two AGR cars.
Well, remember, right before we went to break, Dixon was up in third place. Now he's dropped back two spots. It's now Tony Kanaan leading Dario Franchitti. Sam Hornish Jr. has moved all the way from seventh up to third. Weldon's now fourth. Dixon is fifth. Thomas Schechter rounds out your top six. On board right now with Franchitti.
And you can see the sun starting to settle as the cars are coming out of turn four. Something that will end up happening with these cars as they start to get further into the race, because the sun will start to settle. And going through turn four, you look off to the west. It's been so hot here, so humid here. Temperatures in the 90s. The humidity has been somewhere around 75 to 80%. Track temperature's been up around 125 to 130. Just really hot conditions. There's that sun again. Going inside the visor right now of the drivers, and usually you can use a dark visor during the day, but remember, we're going to start running when the sun goes down, so a lot of these drivers will start off with a clear visor and just sort of squint your eyes a little bit as you go through the turn to sort of block out that sun.
Well, we have got a nice five-car freight train hauling down the backstretch into turn number three, and it's been Tony Kanaan leading all 29 laps. He's never won here at Kentucky. In fact, Andretti Green has never won at Kentucky. Well, the Champ Car World Series continues on ABC tomorrow. Sebastian Bourdais holds a slim 10-point lead. Can he win at the only track he's never won at in Champ Car? It is Elkhart Lake, ABC, tomorrow at 3 Eastern. And if you need more racing, well, tonight, 12:30 on ESPN2. Of course, it'll be qualifying for NHRA drag racing. And they'll race tomorrow night, 7 p.m., right here on ESPN2. The sun continues to set. It's becoming an issue heading through turn four. It's still Kanaan, Franchitti, and Hornish running one, two, and three.
Whoa!
Whoa, look out, Sam's in trouble! And he's got... Dan Weldon is also spinning. Weldon may save it. No. Weldon, an innocent victim in this one. Sam just lost it coming out of two.
Sorry, I just... couldn't do anything.
Yeah, I know. You had nowhere to go.
Unfortunate for Dan Weldon. You see both drivers moving around in the car, which is always a good sign. Remember, Sam had a situation where the back
exactly
end of the car was
loose.
Guys
back in the garage.
And the back end wants to come around on you. As the car starts to continue its run, sometimes the conditions start to get changing and the car starts to get worse. And he would be changing the car during a pit stop, whether wing angles, tire pressures, something to improve the car, but he just didn't get that far.
These two guys, remember, tied for the championship last year. Sam won it in a tiebreaker because he had more wins. They now, well, for Dan, it's his fourth DNF with crashes, or fourth time he's crashed. And take a look as we go one more time here.
Yep, Sam was trying to get a run down the bottom of Franchitti. And what he was looking to do was just to sort of gain some speed going down to the middles of turn one and two. And then Franchitti just started to come, probably take the air off the car. Here we watch again. Sam's on the bottom side in the Team Penske machine. The car just steps out. He collects it. and then the car just releases and the back end comes around and you are a passenger at that point in time. Now for Weldon, comes across the grass, obviously no adhesion on the grass, and there again he's just a passenger. He's trying to slow it down. You see the wall coming as Dan Weldon was going across the grass as we watch this one more time.
Let's go on board with Sam's car. We'll just listen.
Yep, and then he takes his hands off the wheel. You see that? As soon as he knows he's going to impact the wall, he takes his hand off the wheel. Now here we are with Dixon watching everything up above. He sees Sam go off, and he just misses that. And that's not a time to think about things. That's just a reaction. Takes his right hand and changes the fuel setting.
Well, as we mentioned, it's the fourth crash this year for Weldon. It is the third for Sam Hornish. If we had told you at the beginning of the year, between the two of them, they'd have seven crashes, you'd have said we'd be crazy. But it's happened again. And pits are open, so let's send it down to Jack Arute. They're coming your way.
Well, there'll be major changes for Dario Franchitti, minor changes for Tony Kanaan and Scott Dixon. Well, we'll just have to wait and see. They've been pretty mum. For Tony Kanaan, Dixon will hit his pit first. Tony Kanaan will make an air pressure adjustment to take on 22 gallons of fuel. For Scott Dixon, it looks like it's going to be a nominal stop. But for Dario Franchitti, they make an adjustment because the car had severe understeer. And then it's the mad dash to the line that'll determine who will be leading.
Well, it looked like they did put a few turns in Dixon's front wing. I don't know what's in or out. Here's the race off pit road. Dario Franchitti gets the race lead as Tony Kanaan will fall back one spot. Elio Castroneves picks up four spots and will come out in fifth. Remember, he started 13th, and he'll be the lone shot for Team Penske for a chance to win tonight, as it will be for Scott Dixon for Ganassi Racing. We're going to go side by side. All right, back here at Kentucky Speedway, we're under our first caution, and Dario Franchitti has taken over the race lead. The first 38 laps led by Tony Kanaan. That is significant. Kanaan, remember, 81 markers behind. You get three bonus points for leading the most laps. Let's take a look at the race off pit road, and we can show you exactly how close it was.
Now, those yellow cones are the pit exit line. You can see the nose of Franchitti's car just beating Tony Kanaan's 7-Eleven machine across the line. And then shortly after that fall Thomas Schechter and Scott Dixon and Elio Castroneves. And wonder makes you wonder if Castroneves took on a full load of fuel, because he certainly moved up quite a few spots from what was a terrific pit stop. Now, here's the crash again. Sam Hornish is on the low side behind the two cars in front. Remember, this track is very bumpy. So in the scenario where you're down there, maybe just losing a little bit of assistance of the air going across the wings to help hold the car, which is exactly what happened. Suspension probably just couldn't keep up and lost grip with the road.
Take a look, looking out from Tony Kanaan.
Back end steps out of Sam, and off it goes, and then he's just a passenger.
All right, let's check in with Vince Welch. He's with Roger Penske.
Roger, I heard Sam say on the radio that he thought the car felt a little loose. Did you believe that had anything to do with the incident?
Well, Vince, that was probably about 10 or 12 or 13 laps ago, probably at lap 14, and all we did is adjust our bars and a weight checker. He was fine. You can see what happened. You get in behind that car, you don't have any air on your front. I think he had a little push, overcorrected, and, you know, these things are running right on eggs anyhow to try to go fast, but it's a tough day for us. But Helio's out there, had a good pit stop. Nobody got hurt, which is the most important thing, and we just got to keep going.
Try to repair the car for Sam and get it back out or not?
Oh, yeah, we'll keep going. We need the points. So as we did last week, the guys did a great job. Matt Johnson went back and said, let's get this thing back on the track.
Trying to repair it again, guys, 2 weeks in a row. Disappointment for the sixth car.
And it was a miraculous recovery, not only for that team, but let's go back and give a tip of the hat to Scott Dixon's crew. They got their car out. A.J. Foyt, the fourth, got their car back out onto the track after the crash. Tip of the hat to those crews.
And I think that's what all the teams know they have to do up and down the garage area today, simply from the fact if you're going to win the championship, you're going to have to be consistent. Remember, we did a poll down at Homestead at the very first test of the year, asked a lot of the drivers, how do you think you're going to win the championship, and they say, well, yes, race wins, but you're going to have to be consistent, and if you're not winning, you're going to have to be on the podium all the time.
All right, let's check in with Brianne Pettigo. She's caught up with Dan Weldon.
Guys, I'm with Dan Weldon at the Infield Care Center. Dan, is this just another situation of wrong place at the wrong time?
Yeah, it was, you know, just unfortunate. I think Sam got loose in Dario's dirty air and spun, and just was trying to sneak around the outside of him. Unfortunately, I couldn't quite get underneath him, and he just clipped me barely, but no, it's a shame for everybody at Target Chip Ganassi Racing, but no, Scott's still in the race, and hopefully he can clamber back some points on Dario, which would be great for the team.
Any chance we'll see you get back out there?
I'm not sure. The car's really not, you know, he barely touched me. It was pretty unfortunate. So, you know, hopefully we can get back out and salvage some points. But, you know, at the end of the day, it's just unfortunate. It's a tough race. I think we had a very competitive car. And, you know, the 10 crew's just been a little unlucky this year. But we'll keep working at it.
Jack?
Well, Maria's teammate, Scott Dixon, indeed did put one full turn of front wing into the car. And that's why he's back behind Scheckter. But on this restart, guys, you need to watch Dario Franchitti. You would think he would want to be out front to try and maybe get some points for leading the most laps. He just radioed Tony Kanaan's team to say, TK is faster than me. On the start, I'm going to let him lead, and I'll be the wingman.
All right, well, it's going to be an interesting strategy as we're on board with Dario Franchitti. Speed's picking up, and the green flag is already out. So we're back racing here on lap 43 at Kentucky. Well, if he's going to let him go around, he better do it soon.
Well, I think he was thinking about yesterday because he had a great car, and Tony had the same setup, went out in qualifying, went a couple of miles an hour faster. So I think that overall, and once you're in the lead, Marty, I think you like to stay there myself as a driver.
Right. While all this is going on, Brian Pettigo has caught up with Sam Hornish.
Marty, we're walking back towards the garage to check the damage on Sam Hornish's car. Sam, this has got to be like deja vu all over again. Can you walk us through this moment?
We had a good car, moved up, you know, real quick on the start, and it was unfortunate. You know, Dario picked the outside line going in there. I tried to get to the inside of him and just came down and took the air off the car. And unfortunately, as soon as you get to the other side of it, puts a whole bunch of downforce on the front, and the back end came around, and, you know, nothing I could really do about it at that time.
Your crew did an amazing hustle last week and got you back out on the track. Are we going to see that here tonight?
Well, I'm sure they're going to work hard at it. I don't know if they'll be able to get the job done or not, but you know, I'm sure we'll get back out there, but we'll see what happens.
We're glad to see he's okay, guys.
Yeah, I'm glad everybody's okay. I'm sure everyone at home is as well. We're back out on lap 47. You saw the view. Look at that bump coming out of turn two. I mean, it is wicked coming through there. There is third place, Thomas Scheckter. Give him a little bit of salute because he was sixth before the round of pit stops. Comes out in P3. Now, he has not had a lot of success at this track. Three times he's finished 21st or worse in five prior starts. His best was seventh last year.
And we spoke to Larry Curry this morning, the manager for Vision Racing, which Thomas drives for, and he said, you know, we started off so strong in the season, got into a lull in the middle, and he said, it's my responsibility, my job, to turn things around. So over the past couple of weeks, I've taken a group of employees together, got them together. We've had some working units. We've decided we're going to make some changes and some small internal changes, changing of engineers. And Al Bodie, who used to actually be with Thomas Scheckter, has now moved over to Ed Carpenter's car, and David Cripps has now moved over to the two machine you see there of Thomas Scheckter. And he said just small things, watching pit stops, changing the way the guys are working in their pit stops, because we used to lose a few positions during a pit stop itself. He said, we have a great team, a great nucleus, we are building. We were a one-car team, then a two-car team, we're now in our third year of existence, and we are a three-car team. We're not a super team yet, but we are working towards that. And you certainly enjoy listening to a team manager who really has his thoughts really going in the right direction.
Another guy who has moved up is Elio Castroneves. Remember, he started 13th. The last time he started back that far was Watkins Glen of 2005. He's now worked his way up to fifth place, and he's carrying the Penske colors alone, Vince Welch.
Well, and in typical Penske team fashion, they gained some of those spots in the pit lane. And Scott Goodyear made note of their quick pit stop and the fact that they did make up some margin. They tell me they did not quick fuel, that it was just quick stop. And Elio told me yesterday they were going to need that kind of performance in the pit lane and on track if he was going to come from 13th to win this race today. Was complaining earlier of a little bit of push in 3 and 4, but not complaining after that first stop.
Well, Jack Root, we're getting ready to go side by side. I need you to talk to the Andretti Green guys and see what happened to that plan about letting Tony Kanaan go back out front, because right now it is Dario Franchitti still running in front of his teammate Tony Kanaan in third. It's Thomas Scheckter, Scott Dixon, Elio Castroneves. That's your top five as we step aside here at Kentucky Speedway. Well, Back here at Kentucky Speedway, it's Dario Franchitti leading Tony Kanaan. Third is Thomas Schechter. He's got his hands full with Scott Dixon. Elio Castroneves has dropped back into the clutches of Scott Sharp. They've got their separate battle going for the top five positions. Jack, we talked about this a little bit before. You think this is a little cat and mouse? I mean, the guy who's always leading gets worse fuel mileage. We know that.
Well, Marty, I checked with George Klutz, who calls the shots on the 7-Eleven car, and he shrugged his shoulders and said, no, Dario said that. He said, if we're faster, so we'll let him go by. And then he's the one that brought up the fact, he said, but you notice, Jack, the race speeds have dropped by a mile an hour or so. So I asked him, I said, well, does that mean you're trying to conserve fuel? He said, I don't think you can find out for sure, because we'd have to ask TK.
So what do you think there, Mr. Analyst?
Well, you know something, if you're leading the race and you're Dario Franchitti and you can do it without having anybody chasing you up that you have to worry about. You've got your teammate back there right now. You know he's not going to take you out. This is a situation I think is good for him because he needs to lead some laps if he can to get those three bonus points that you talked about, Marty. So I think Dario maybe had a change of heart. Maybe he changes on his car during the pit stop, made his car work a little bit better and easier for him. But I've got to say that Kanaan looks like he's being aggressive to try to get around. Tucks in behind him going down the straightaways to conserve a little bit of fuel and gets out from behind him going through the turns to get some of that air going over the wings and through the under tray of the car just to get some good grip so he doesn't have the same problem that Sam Hornish did. Watch
but
this.
But Scott, isn't that exactly the same scenario just in reverse of what we saw before the first pit stop? These two are running in lock sync.
And that's pretty much what they're doing right now. And you think that they would have a handle on this and good communication between the two. Maybe the communication just didn't get there, Jack. Who knows?
Well, one thing we know for sure, watch the bump that these guys hit coming through turn two. It's right near the exit. We've got all three views. Take a look. It's coming up right there. Now, it doesn't look bad here. Let's go back, take a look at it in slow motion.
Just watch the wheels on the car and then the body itself. And as the car goes over the bumps, you can see just a little bit of a lurch right there. A lot of movement. Remember, these cars only run an inch off the ground. And now that suspension is taking up all the travel. If that bump wasn't there, the suspension would be adjusted to be lower to the track and the cars would go just a little bit quicker. But as I mentioned, this track was built in 2000, a terrific racetrack, but the winters are harsh enough here to give this track just a lot of bumps over the years.
And remember, every time you hit a bump, it sort of has a tendency to destabilize the car, which gives you your hands full. Take a look, you got a battle for fifth, and then a little bit further back, you got a battle for seventh going on. That is Elio Castroneves and Scott Sharp. They're duking it out for fifth. Right behind them, it's Danica Patrick and A.J. Foyt, the fourth, going after seventh. So we do have some action all over the racetrack, side by side down the backstretch.
Remember, this is 212 to 15 miles an hour in average all the time. And it just puts a lot of pressure on you mentally to go around this racetrack that close. Now it looks like Elio is going to try a different tactic. He gets back up behind Scott Sharp. Looks for some clean air going through the turn. He's got to be very cognizant that the people coming up behind him, Danica Patrick and A.J. Foyt the fourth, another driver for Vision Racing, is starting to fill his mirrors. And we talk about Vision Racing, you got Ed Carpenter running in 10th, so Vision has all three cars running in the top 10 today, Marty.
Well, let's get an update from pit lane, Vince Welch.
Well, they're really giving a pep talk to Scott Sharp on the radio, telling him he's doing an awesome job as he made that move on Castroneves a moment ago. He had complained about a loose race car earlier in that initial stint, but they made a right front tire pressure adjustment. The car has responded to it, and Sharp is cruising along in a very comfortable car and keeping an eye on that lead pack. Remember, we told you at the beginning, he said that was going to be key. He's not with it right now, but he can see it, guys, and maybe that's a little bit of the rabbit as Elio takes a peek on the outside.
He's 2.4 seconds behind the last time by the stripe. He lost about 0.2 of a second the last lap. We've got a moment while all this is going on. Let's bring in our GoDaddy.com trivia question. And today is, who is the last driver not on Team Penske, Target Chip Ganassi, or AGR to win an IndyCar Series race? The clock is ticking. Tick-tock.
I think I gave this one away during our grid.
Yeah, you did. You gave it away. In fact, we just talked about the man, and he's running in fifth right now. Scott Sharp back here at Kentucky back in 2005, and that is 32 races ago, folks. That's how many races in a row the three top teams have won. Let's flash back to 2005 here at Kentucky and give Scott his due because there he is. And he was running the Delphi car, this familiar number 8.
as the leader right now in most consecutive starts in the IndyCar series. We're really going to call him the Ironman. He's 39 years old. He's been working out. I would say he's in shape of the guys that are like in their 20s here in this series right now, and very motivated, and he's going to be going along here just like the Andretti. Mario Andretti continued to just defy everything, continue driving into his 50s, and Scott Sharp looks like he's not going to stop anytime soon.
And earlier this year, he crossed the $10 million plateau in winnings in the IndyCar series. Take a look at that four-car gaggle as they are just going after each other. Everybody's close, but they got to get closer to the three and five that are up front. Dario Franchitti continues to lead. Ah, yes, we're so used to Kentucky being the land of horse racing. Our horsepower is just a little bit more. Instead of one each, we've got about a few hundred more. And sometimes when we crash a lot harder. All right, let's take a look at the lead pack as it is now Dario Franchitti and Tony Kanaan. They have opened up about a half a second over third place Thomas Schechter. And we are working lap number 78. And that means that Dario Franchitti has now led more laps than Tony Kanaan. And that's significant in the championship. I mean, Kanaan really needs to get around him if he can. He's got to lead the most laps. He's got to pick up every point he can possibly get and win this race.
Well, they are teammates, and I'm sure they've had some team discussions. And as Michael Andretti, the managing team owner, has said, there is no team orders between our drivers. If a driver can go out and win, then they can go ahead and do it. But I got to imagine right now that TK is very cognizant of laps led. If he's not counting in his own head, he certainly is hearing it from his team management. But in this situation now, if he can get by, I'm sure that he would. But Dario is going to make the car just a little wide going through the turn, as he does each time entering into one and entering into three.
Well, the top three in points here at Kentucky Speedway have not had a great deal of success at this track. Let's take a look at the top teams. Penske, Andretti Green, Ganassi. They've had poles. And you can see the laps led, but only one win, and that was last year by Sam Hornish.
Well, that may change today, but as we talked about, it is always consistency that wins championships. Whether you're trying to win your first race, as we are with Danica Patrick, who's on board right now, going underneath Castroneves.
Outside.
Oh, and looked like we're going to try it three wide. That's AJ, the fourth, and that's a bad place to be up there. He's going to have to get out of the throttle, and he's going to lose a lot of position.
Well, he surprised Castroneves on the outside, and with Danica going on the low side, Castroneves had to hold his line, could not give AJ the fourth any room. And smartly, AJ got off the loud pedal.
So Danica moves up to six. Let's get more from Vince Welch.
Well, guys, and Castroneves is fighting a bad push status with his race car as well. So, Scott, that didn't make that any more comfortable when he had a car on the outside. He didn't have much room to go as far as Castroneves is concerned because he's been struggling with the car to keep it down.
Now, talking about another car who is struggling, you notice the 15 car has just been put a lap down. That is Buddy Rice. I mean, the Dreyer-Reinbold team, both cars have not done well this weekend. They're running 15th and 16th. They're the last two on the lead lap. In fact, Buddy's now one down, as we said.
L5, Buddy, L5.
That includes Hornish in 17th and Weldon listed in 18th, and they crashed out.
And there's Sarah Fisher, the number five car in the Amco car, was on the bottom part of the racetrack there, letting the cars go by on the high side. They have just struggled with getting the cars to go fast around here, looking like they were looking for some answers throughout practice and qualifying. But sometimes when the cars do not load off the trailer fast, it's really a long weekend because a lot of times you cannot make the cars get that much quicker. Lap two sounds like for Danica Patrick now before fueling.
Yeah, and that means that we're going to see a green flag pit stops unless the yellow comes out, as Danica has closed down on Scott Sharp.
Just work on your timing. You've got a faster car.
Now, here's a situation where it's really up to the drivers. We talk about the in-lap. As soon as you get told to come into the pits, she'll get told one more lap to go, this time by. And she knows that. Her job is to come off the track as fast as possible onto the turn three apron and get around on the pit road entrance, which also is very bumpy here. All the drivers know and are aware of it, and the best drivers will make up the best time on the entrance and also on the pit exit to gain time coming in and out of the pits.
We have seen incidents where drivers have taken it back out onto the track because they've been too hot coming into pit lane or exiting, for that matter. So we're working lap 87 of 200. We've already seen our first round.
Might be in this lap or one more, so keep the pressure on.
There's our Firestone telemetry on Danica.
Look at that sun. She keeps her foot into it, still 100% throttle. You can see that running in the air. The car in front is very difficult. You watch her hands, they'll move around a lot for her. Probably somewhere just close to about 35 to 40 degrees in the steering. You see just over 40 a few times, high G-forces.
All right, and you can see as she's got her hands full, especially some of those bumps. There's that sun glare we've been talking about. It gets worse and worse. And there comes Elio Castroneves. So he is peeling off. And Vince, we're going to send it your way.
Elio has had his issues on the ovals this year. In fact, his last six oval races, his average finish is 12th. Some of those mistakes have been his own. Some have been certainly uncharacteristic. Remember, he was leading when the wing fell off at Milwaukee. They want to get it turned around for the final four races of the season with a good, strong run today. Rick Reinemann working on the outside front. They've made a tire pressure adjustment and also a wing change there on the front. And away for Castroneves, his second good stop here today.
And here comes your leader, Dario Franchitti, as he peels off and makes the way through turn three. And this is what we were talking about. It's very flat. You get that sensation of you're going too slow, and then all of a sudden you're looping yourself around.
You can see the bumps there coming into pit lane. Very tricky job for drivers.
All right, let's send it down to Jack Aru. He's heading your way, Jack.
Dario Franchitti thought he was going to be coming in with his teammate and that Tony Kanaan would be following him. But so much for team orders or team camaraderie. It will be Franchitti all by himself. John Anderson calling the shots. Changes just 22 gallons of fuel, and Dario Franchitti will try and get out in the first series of in over 500 miles of competition.
Well, and here comes Tony Kanaan one lap later, right behind him. So you're right, they won't be in lockstep unless the pit crew does its job and they manage to make the outlap work. He's there.
Yeah, Kanaan made a wide entry. As Tony Kanaan's crew will go to work, they don't anticipate making any changes. In fact, they do not. But they're going to pack the car full of fuel. And here, right behind him, Scott Dixon in lockstep with Kanaan. Let's go to Brianne Bettigo.
Danica Patrick just pulled out of her pit stall. They took four Firestones, filled it up with 22 gallons of ethanol, made no changes to the number seven car. It looked like there was a bit of a delay on that left front tire, but she is out and away.
Well, so cycling through, A.J. Foyt, the fourth, picked up the lead. So he has led one lap officially, although he is now into pit lane, and he will surrender it back to, well, we'll have to wait to see who comes across the line in timing and scoring. There is Danica Patrick, and there is Tony Kanaan.
You saw all those sparks from the back of Danica Patrick's car when she exited the pit lane. Remember, a full tank of fuel now and new tires, so low tire pressures also until the heat gets built up on it. The car will bang the ground just a little bit. There's nothing braking on that car when she's leaving pit lane.
All right. As a result of the two team cars not pitting together, Tony Kanaan has got the race lead. Second place is Scott Dixon. Dario Franchitti is in third. So there he is. You see how far back he is. Thomas Schechter is fourth. Scott Sharp comes out in fifth. So that's your top five right now as the pit stops continue to cycle through. That's Koski Matsura. He is well down in 12th place. We'll go side by side here at Kentucky. Here at Kentucky Speedway, we've just had our second round of pit stops. It's Tony Kanaan out in front of Scott Dixon by a half a second, but look who's right there side by side with Dixon battling for position, the two that are battling for the championship. Dario Franchitti on the outside in the 27, down the backstretch. He wants to get back around him.
Looks like Franchitti has a faster car down in turns one and two. Dixon maybe a little quicker just down that backstretch entering into three, coming out of four where the bumps are pretty bad also. The cars look just about even. Let's see if Franchitti can make some headway now running on the high line again.
Now while we were in side by side, we passed the halfway mark. We're at working on lap 103.
You heard Dario say, tell TK I could do with some help there. But I got to tell you, Marty, if I'm TK right now, it's like I'm looking in the mirror going, I'm leading laps. I might get the three bonus points, and it's not the last race of the season. You two aren't battling for a tie in the championship. I'm pretty happy up here.
Well, and TK has now led 50 laps. Dario led 52 so far, so he's not coming back. I mean, he knows he needs those three bonus points. And you see the points. I mean, right now, if it finished, the gap would narrow from 24 to 22. but that could change and probably will.
I guess if Dario doesn't think he's getting much help from TK, then TK will have to drive back to the airport and not get a ride on Dario's Euro helicopter on the way out of here tonight. But all man for himself. I always say that when you're running, even with teammates. Like I said, it's not down to the very last race for the very last couple of laps. And last year we had a tie in the championship, and I'm sure TK would actually lead and turn over the lead if he had to on the very last race of the season to be able to give his teammate the championship if he had to do it. That's something you would do internally as a driver, not even with team owners.
You want to keep pressure on. Good job.
You heard the all clear. That's from Dario Franchitti back to Thomas Schechter in fourth. But Scott Sharp is in fifth. And let's go back to his last pit stop, Scott.
Marty, we talk about the driver pressure doing a great in-lap and out-lap during pit stops. Well, there's also a lot of pressure on the team to correct themselves during a pit stop also. Here is the left rear tire changer right now from the helmet cam. And the wheel drops out of the wheel gun itself. And that's not a problem really from the tire changer itself. Sometimes the gun just releases that nut, but Don Hoff, the tire changer, what a great job. No panic, just grabs it, puts the wheel gun back up to it, gets the car back out on way.
So there you see Scott still in fifth place. AJ Foyt, the fourth, is sixth. Danica Patrick, seventh. Elio Castroneves, eighth. Marco Andretti, ninth. Ed Carpenter rounds out your top 10. There is Scott Dixon. Dario Franchitti has managed to get around him now without the help of Tony Kanaan. And there is Tony Kanaan as he is leading this event as we have just completed another lap. We're working lap 109 of 200. Let's get you up to speed if you're just joining us. Jaggeroot, you're up.
Yeah, let's talk about Tony Kanaan. Remember, Kanaan was told by Dario Franchitti after the first caution that he would let Kanaan lead because he thought he was faster. And then Dario decided to lead. Well, what does Tony Kanaan repay that with? Not pitting with Dario Franchitti. That gave Tony Kanaan the lead. Dario Franchitti pitted first. He now finds himself in second position after battling the man that has dropped back to third spot, that being Scott Dixon, who is chasing Franchitti for the point lead. Packy Wheeler, who calls the shots from high atop toward Scott Dixon, just told Scott, just worry about what you can see. Let's check in with Brianne.
Jack, right behind Scott Dixon in fourth position is Thomas Schechter, who is thrilled to be back running towards the top of the field. He's been playing a bit of cat and mouse game with his friend off the track, Scott Dixon, but this shakeup in Vision Racing with changing engineers internally has played well for Thomas Schechter. Vince?
Scott Sharp in the 8 car is running in 5th. We just saw the helmet cam from his inside rear tire changer, Don Huff. And what's amazing is that when he lost that wheel nut, they did not lose any positions on the stop. They came in 5th, went out 5th with no chassis adjustments. That gives you an indication of how quick that crew worked despite the mistake. They're very happy with their race car right now. Brian Pettigo.
Well, it's more good news for Vision Racing. AJ Foyt, the fourth, currently running in 6th position, keeps being told by his crew that he is indeed faster than the cars in front of him, and he is indeed gaining ground. Right behind him in 7th position is Danica Patrick, who is battling a little bit of a handling problem. They keep encouraging her to use the tools she has at her disposal inside the cockpit, keeping her focused. She's complaining that it's very, very difficult to pass at this moment on the track. Vince?
Elio Castroneves is running in the 8th spot. Remember, he started 13th. They've moved their way up, but they've been battling understeer throughout the course of the night. They had a front wing adjustment on their first stop, tire pressure adjustment, and more wing adjustment on the second stop. So that gives you an indication of what a handful it is for Elio Castroneves and his teammate Sam Hornish crashed earlier. We've just gotten word they will not be able to repair the car. They are done. Brianne?
Who's in 9th position as well. And here's one reason why. Marco is typically used to running a 120 to a 122 suspension. This weekend, he switched to what his teammates Dario Franchitti and Tony Kanaan run, which is a 118 suspension. The difference between the two guys, it's like driving a Cadillac one weekend and switching to a Jeep off-road vehicle the next. So Marco is complaining of a bit of understeer. Right behind Marco Andretti in the 10th position is Ed Carpenter. This is a new team somewhat for Ed Carpenter this weekend. They have two new guys on the crew, a new left rear tire changer in Kenny Davis and a new front right tire changer in Jeff Campbell. They're working to find the right combination to get these guys in the front, and guys, it looks like it's working. Vince?
Next in line is Vitor Mera, currently running in 11th. He's up one spot from where he started in the 12th position. It's been a very tough stretch for Vitor, two straight DNFs. His average finish is 15th in the last four races, but this is a racetrack where they feel like maybe they can just get to the finish. Maybe some good things will happen, but right now he's down one lap, Vitor Mera. Marty?
And Vitor is a lap down, as is Koski Matsura in 12th, Darren Manning in 13th, Buddy Rice, Sarah Fisher, and then three laps down, it's Ryan Hunter-Reay. That rounds out the 16 cars still running. And all of a sudden, we've got word that the Sharp machine, Scott Sharp, is coming down pit lane, and as he makes his way down, reminder will be at the Optima Batteries IndyCar Grand Prix of Sonoma, and we'll get you more on that. Scott brings it in. And I'm wondering if they had an issue with the tire. This is too early.
Well, it looks like it's a routine stop with Force Firestone Firehawk tires. Then the fueler gets tapped, and now he's off. So maybe he had a tire going down, which you would know from the telemetry that's actually on board, the computers on board, tire sensors on each of those four tires, sending those signals back to the engineers. And Vince Welsh, you have more information on Scott Sharp?
Had an issue on their last stop. They did not get a full fill, so they had to come back in because they were low on fuel. So their stint wasn't as long as previous stints.
Yeah, the 28 laps since his last stop, so that would be make sense if they didn't get a full load of fuel. They'd have to make that change there. We were wondering if it was a tire, but now we know it's fuel. Thank you, Vince. Good job. All right, and he's in jeopardy here of getting into more deep trouble. He's already a lap down as they had to pit under the green. They show him in 14th now on the official board. Meanwhile, Tony Kanaan, Dario Franchitti, Scott Dixon, Thomas Schechter. There's Schechter in the mix as well. And there's your top five here at Kentucky. And we are back under our second caution of the day as we have a report of debris up in turn three. As a bad break for Scott Sharp as he got caught out. And right now, Scott is one lap down. Tough break because he was running well in the top five. But right now it's Tony Kanaan with Dario Franchitti, Scott Dixon third, Thomas Schechter fourth, and his vision teammate A.J. Foyt the fourth with his best run this year.
He looked very impressive very early on, just even yesterday. I noticed from standing up here in our television booth, watching him in practice, it looked like he had a lot more confidence with the car. He was confident in moving the car around, and he was actually being aggressive. So I'm very pleased to see that for him. I think a very talented race car driver. He's now in a team that I think he can work well and have some teammates to rely upon, because he really is a rookie in the sense of not having just a ton of miles in these type of cars. Remember, he's a Indy Pro Series champion, has done very well in the learning ranks, but these big cars with 650 horsepower provided by those Honda engines, Marty, it's a lot of car to handle.
His career best was eighth. Right now he's running fifth. Let's get an update on Elio Castroneves. Vince, you got a report, is something wrong?
Yeah, they've been dealing with Elio's car throughout the course of the night. Wing adjustments on the first two stops, and they're going to take out a half a turn of front wing on this stop. They are complaining, Elio is, that there's a vibration in the car, and he's also talking about some power issues. Feels as though he might be losing some power, or the power is inconsistent. So it's been a tough night for Elio as you see him come down on pit lane.
And you can see that just about everybody is coming in. Let's get you set up for our ethanol triple pits. Jack Root, it's all yours.
Yeah, and Marty, Scott Dixon was right behind Ed Carpenter. Lap car was not happy with the way Carpenter was not pulling up to the rear decklid of Dario Franchitti. No changes on Tony Kanaan. No changes on Dario Franchitti. We'll have to see if there will be any changes on Scott Dixon. So far, he likes the car. And after they are done, the slowest car coming out was Dario Franchitti. But by virtue of his first pit stall, it didn't help him. He still was third in the queue, as Scott likes to say.
And it has actually Scott Dixon first off pit row, picking up two spots. Tony Kanaan and Dario Franchitti drop one respectively. And there you can see that Danica Patrick managed to pick up a spot, as did Marco Andretti. So
we've completed. When you come by, it'll be 129, almost 130, 70 to go.
So 70 to go means one more pit stop for sure. So we're going to get things cleaned up. You see the vehicle out there in turn three. They're picking up the debris. So we'll step aside here at Kentucky. Back here in Kentucky under our second caution. And we want to update you. Scott Sharp stayed out. And look at this. The number 10, Dan Weldon Machine, is coming back out. He's 95 laps down, but hats off, guys. Never say die. Jack?
Well, there is a bit of concern about Scott Sharp as we look at them going to work on Elio Castroneves' car. Obviously, some of that 200-mile-an-hour duct tape being put to use. Immediately when Scott Sharp, when Scott Dixon found out that his teammate was coming back out, the two AGR cars were notified of the reappearance of Weldon, and they were cautioned, specifically Dario Franchitti, that most likely they should be on the lookout, that Weldon will try to hook up with Dixon and try to maybe make it a two-car tango, one car many laps down, however.
All right, thanks for the update, and there you see Weldon coming back in. Let's go back to the pit stops.
Scott Dixon had a great stop, and watch how fast he comes out, swings to the very outside, puts a little pressure on TK. TK comes over and almost takes his own teammate out, Dario Franchitti. But in all this that you had mentioned, with all this busyness here, we got cars even driving on the grass here. This is just a very busy time as we watch everybody start to leave the pit lane, and we're back to green, Marty.
And we want to put a period on that Scott Sharp story. He is back on the lead lap by staying out there, and he is shown in eighth position as they come across the line. So it is not over for all you fans of Scott Sharp. Meanwhile, up front, take a look, as it is Tony Kanaan.
10 back to Dario, now 5.
And Dixon moves up and gets in the draft of Tony Kanaan, but doesn't seem to be enough because the guy that got the real good draft there, Marty, is a 27 of Dario Franchitti.
See if they can hold him off. Kanaan shoots back out front, and here goes Franchitti trying to finish it off.
Still got a wheel on you, coming back a little bit.
Coming through this time. They show Dixon still in second place, Dario third, but they're almost neck and neck. Thomas Schechter is fourth. Danica Patrick rounds out your top five.
Here's the turn 3-4 segment again. Look at that sun again, Marty, coming into the eyes. This might play a bit of a role on people just still trying to get through the turns there. This is longer than we usually have. It usually hangs out there for about 30, 40, or 50 laps, but because of the time of day that we are running here, it just has played havoc with those drivers going through the turn. Remember, they're seeing the sun at 215 miles an hour.
Not a pleasant sight. Not a pleasant sight if you're anybody but Tony Kanaan, because he's got the clean air up front. He's running the fastest laps, 214.9 miles an hour right now. In fact, this last one up to 215.9. And in second place, Dixon, Franchitti. They're running about a half a mile an hour slower right now, and he's all alone out front.
Seems like TK has the car. Remember, the same setup that his teammate Dario Franchitti had, but he was just also much faster in qualifying. I mean, I asked Dario, and he said, I don't know where he got the speed, but boy, is he quick.
Yeah, he was 2 miles an hour faster than second place Dario Franchitti.
And you remember last week, it was Dario that had the speed and was just able to drive through the field after his miscue during the pit stop itself. Now we're also seeing some sparks come up from the bottom of the cars. Remember, 22 gallons of ethanol fuel were just put on board, so a lot of weight added back onto the cars. And then the four fresh Firestone Firehawk tires, until they get a few laps running around here to build up the temperature and the pressure to help raise the car off the ground. These cars do touch the ground just a little bit until all those things come into place.
Well, we've got 10 cars right now on the lead lap. There's Danica Patrick. Let's check in, see how she's faring right now. Her fastest lap so far today has been 218.2 miles an hour. In fact, that is the fastest race lap other than Dan Weldon before his crash. But right now, she's in fifth, about 1.6 seconds behind the leader and running at 215 and change.
So possibly some changes have been made to her race car to improve it, because she certainly seems to be on the pace with Tony Kanaan's time right now.
Marco Andretti and Ed Carpenter, that is a battle for position as well. That's sixth and seventh.
We talked about Vision Racing and the 20 car. Ed Carpenter on the high side right now, trying to get around the New York Stock Exchange machine of Marco Andretti on the low side. The part of the Vision Racing team, what an improvement they've had here for the past couple of races.
Well, and Carpenter gained his positions in the pits exchange. No tires, they just went for fuels, and so far that has paid off for him. So we have about 59 laps to go. You can see he's actually pulling away from Marco a little bit now. And Marco's falling into the clutches of Scott Sharp. So while that goes on, let's go back and take a look at, again, the battle for second. And this is between the two in the championship hunt. Jack, you've got more on this battle?
Oh, yeah, it's been unfolding like this lap after lap after lap. So finally, Dario Franchitti radioed to his spotter and said, ask TK if he can give me some help with the draft. Scott, you know what that means. He wants TK to kind of maybe pull up just a little bit so that maybe he can get some of that air on the high side in that high groove. Guess what? Silence when George Klutz made that request of his driver, Tony Kanaan.
What do you think?
You're a race driver. You want to go win races. So, I mean, there you go.
they're good friends off the track, but sorry, buddy. I'm still in the championship hunt, and I've got the race lead, and I'm not slowing down. And he's leading the most laps. He's got the bonus points right now. Tony Kanaan does, if everything stays the same. Why would you come back and help your potential assassin?
When he ended up getting on the pole yesterday, we asked him, remember, we were standing there talking to him after qualifying. He said, what do you have to do? He says, it's simple. I just need to keep winning races. Don't wish any ill will on the people, especially my teammates that are ahead of me in the championship, but I just need to do my job and see what happens.
Take a look. He came in, Tony did, at 81 markers behind. Right now, if it ended, he'd be 63 back. So that is exactly what he needs to do. We're going to step aside as it is Kanaan, Dixon, Franchitti, Schechter, and Patrick. That's your top five if you ride on board with Danica. Back here at Kentucky Speedway, and if you're just joining us, welcome. As we are running race 13 of 17 on the 2007 IndyCar schedule, it is the Optima Batteries IndyCar 300 presented by GoDaddy.com here at Kentucky Speedway. It's been a very interesting race as Tony Kanaan is out in front of Scott Dixon, Dario Franchitti, and then Thomas Schechter, Danica Patrick. That's your top five. I'm Marty Reid along with Scott Goodyear, and you saw that Jack Arup, Brian Pettigo, and Vince Welch are down in pit lane. And it looks like Tony is about to wrap up the most laps led. By my count, it will be about two more laps, and he will not be catchable, so he'll pick up the three bonus. And all of a sudden, Ed Carpenter dips below the line and is bringing his car in. So he is going to peel off from his sixth place where he was. And looking at the last time that Ed pitted was lap 127, so here we are on lap 154.
And that whole group right there was second through about 11th
on
spot.
Brian?
Guys, Ed Carpenter pulling in. They're taking tires and fuel only. Remember, he's short-filled on that last pit stop in order to gain his lap back on the track. He is out without problem, and they believe he will be able to go to the finish.
Well, he should be able to based on what we've seen so far in the green flag stops, but the problem is he is going to be a lap down by the time he gets back out there.
And what he's hoping for is that the rest of the people that are out there right now have to pit under green, so that way he puts himself back on the same lap. But what a great call by Vision Racing just previous to that to bring him in for fuel only, because it got him out right behind Scott Sharp on that last yellow we had. And then because they were down a lap, they got the wave around. So some great foresight and some great calling there by the Vision Racing team.
Meanwhile, you can see the battle for second and third between Dixon and Franchitti. And then there is Danica Patrick, got her own issues with Thomas Schechter as she's trying to go into fourth position. Now, if you were with us last week, you know how heartbroken she was. She thought she had the best car to win. We talked to her about it.
What are you gonna do? You know, this stuff happens in racing all the time. It's just that
I have this question that everybody keeps asking, and you know, they're curious and want to see when I win my first race. And like I said, if it would have been any other race where I had won my first race already, I probably wouldn't be as mad, but I just can't wait to get it over with and have people stop asking me. But I guess the good side of it is that they're still asking me, and you know, it has been a couple of years, so thanks for believing in me. But that was what made it so emotional.
You saw her there in the video battling with the 22 car, or the two car, I should say, of Thomas Schechter, as they're fighting for position between fourth and fifth. Danica has been back and forth with loose, tight, but it hasn't been a car that has been unmanageable, but it has been a little bit tricky for her today. She's done a good job, according to the team, working with her tools inside the car, because they haven't made major changes, just tire pressure and a slight wing adjustment.
But again, not quite able to get the job done to get around Schechter.
Well, when you think about it, just 3 years ago when she came to this series, not really being able to maybe feel the car as well as she does now. But this Danica Patrick this year is very aggressive. She wants to win races, and I think she has more respect from everybody else that's out on the racetrack this year than she did from the year previous or the year before that. Everybody knows that she is a competitor, and I think just being in the team environment that she has now, having three other drivers to draw upon, Marty, gives her a great opportunity to build her confidence.
All right, so as this continues back here in this battle for fifth position, the battle for second continues up a little farther on the track. What it has allowed to have happen is Tony Kanaan has opened up a 2.6 second lead over these two guys as they refuse to fall into lockstep formation to try and reel him back in. In fact, there is Tony, and there's the gap with everybody else. The second fastest race in IndyCar history occurred here in Kentucky at 2003 at over 197 miles an hour. We're lapping at 188 right now, which would make it the fifth fastest race if we continue at this pace. Let's find out what's going on down in pit lane, Jackaroot.
Well, I think as we watch this side-by-side battle for second, as you alluded to, Marty, it's to the benefit of Tony Kanaan. But these two drivers, Dixon on the inside and Franchitti on the outside, find themselves in what we call a drafting conundrum. Neither one of them can run in the opposite lane. What I mean by that is Dixon's car does not work on the high side, and thus far, Franchitti's car won't work on the low side. They've pleaded, their spotters have, with Thomas Schechter to try and come down and help Scott Dixon, but Schechter finds himself also with a problem. His car won't work down in the white line. He's got the middle groove. I like to call this a drafting conundrum.
That's a term that I guess I'm just learning about. I usually like the term discombobulated or something like that, but you talk about the bumps, Jack, and all these drivers right now, as we see Danica Patrick just get pushed down, and she's having her car slide back up the track right near Marco Andretti. Overall, right now, all these cars are running in a situation where they're trying to find their car in the most comfortable place on the racetrack, as you're mentioning, Jack. But the most important thing is they still have one more pit stop to make changes to make their car work high or low. They're going to have to be able to run where they need to pass the cars in front.
Well, A.J. Foyt, the fourth, has moved up to fifth. Marco Andretti, sixth. And Danica has been bumped back to seventh. Vince, what's going on?
Well, she's not liking the feel of her race car right now. And Scott Goodyear, you just made a great point about trying to find a different line. And that's exactly what they told her on the radio. Try the higher side of the track. She kept getting pushed down, so they feel as though maybe if she moves up the track, tries the outside line, maybe the car's handling will be a little better, and they'll pick up a little bit of that speed and comfort that she's looking for.
Well, with all that, Dario Franchitti was way clear, up clear. On the high side there. We're not sure what happened there. We'll have to see if we can get a report on that.
Here it comes. Take another look.
Right beside the 9 machine of Scott Dixon. Goes into the turn. Seems like he's just a little high, even on the entrance. And the car is now up all the way to the fourth lane, guys. That is just talk about making your heart palpitate right there.
And on board.
Just did not turn in for him. You hear him slowly get off the throttle, so he didn't have the back end whip around on him. And then started to continue up with the speed. So now he's back up to speed. We'll have to see if we get a report of what happened with the car there.
Well, what this means in the championship chase, obviously, Dario has dropped all the way back to eighth. Guess who's in second place? Scott Dixon. And in the current standings, look at how it would have an effect. 8 markers back to Dixon. Kanaan would only be 52 behind. This would make it very interesting. So right now you've got Kanaan, Dixon, Schechter, and there is Scott Sharp as he has had to come back into the pits for his last stop.
Starting to wonder if they're actually having a problem with their fueling. To get the fuel in the car. Now, he should make it to the end because we are now in lap 170.
But the problem is it'll probably put him a lap down. We'll check it as there you can see. There is Dixon as he's got Schechter and Danica Patrick. That's second, third, and fourth. What a battle going on here at Kentucky. Back here at Kentucky Speedway, you saw it on side-by-side. Dario Franchitti is back up to sixth from falling back to eighth. Let's get more from Jackaroo.
Yeah, Scott Goodyear, you wanted to know if that was a problem with the car or not, and I quote John Anderson, it was simply Dario's hiccup.
All right, now you guys have got a conundrum. You've got discombobulated, now we have a hiccup?
A hiccup. Well, that's a hiccup you don't want very often, but I guess it was really strange how he just got into the turn. Maybe the front didn't turn for him when he asked it to, amount of understeer, but the car seems to be back on cue now.
All right, Thomas Schechter has peeled off from the line and heading down pit lane. Let's send it to Brianne.
Thomas Schechter just now pulling into his pit stall. I'm not sure if they're going to fill it all the way up. It looks like they're going to. Four tires, no changes to this car. He is happy, guys, and he is pulling out. He can go the distance.
Well, this will be the last round of pit stops. You just need enough to go about 23 laps as far as fuel is concerned. Right now, it's all Tony Kanaan on the left of your screen, now full screen. 4.6 seconds ahead of Scott Dixon. Danica Patrick has cycled to third. A.J. Foyt to fourth with a career-best fourth going. Take a look here, and we get word that these guys touch.
Yes, they did. And the car gets sideways a little bit. Now, remember, we've talked about these two before. Tony Kanaan and the 7-Eleven machine, the number 11 car on your left-hand side of the screen, as we're on board right now with TK, looking down on the 3 machine, the Team Penske machine, and of Elio Castroneves. So, wow.
And that was Castroneves going a lap down. Tony's not going to be real thrilled with that. Here comes your race leader into pit lane. Jaggeroo, he's heading your way.
Yeah, and he will be coming in to take a time stop. Look who else is coming. Franchitti out on the grass.
Pushed out there.
Tear something up under the under tray of the car. It will be a time stop. But for Scott Dixon, look to be fuel only. They're reporting us no tires. Looking to see there is wing damage on Dario Franchitti. Quick out there, quickly is. Well, they're continuing to work on Franchitti's car. Kanaan is off and away. You can see they're going to have to replace that entire nose. That all because he had a foray into the grass and everybody locked it up to get down to that 60-mile-an-hour speed limit.
Well, Jackie actually hit the cone that marks the entry point of where they begin the timing at 60 miles an hour into pit lane. So they make as quick a change as possible. But remember all this. Oh, and Danica has spun it coming out of the pits.
Keep it going, keep it going.
And the yellow is out if she can keep the car fired. No, she can't. So Danica had a great shot there. But our third yellow now comes out. Look at the family. That's her sister to the right.
Unfortunately, because in the situation, if you were just pitting, you leave the pit lane as you look at her husband, Paul Hosenthal. What you're trying to do, remember, trying to make up time on the pit exit. With cold tires, full fuel, the car is really a handful.
So we are under our third caution, and we talked about this treacherous pit lane entrance and exit. Vince, you've got more?
Well, I just want to make the point, those were not cold tires. She took on just fuel. They did not change the rubber when she came down here on that stop. So maybe they cool off a bit, Scott, but they did not put on fresh tires. It was fuel only for Danica. And I know that we're going to look back at the Dario Franchitti incident, and Danica actually is the car that almost collided with Dario that forced him to go out into the grass. So it's certainly been an eventful last couple of minutes for Danica Patrick.
Well, Vince, it all seemed to go wrong for Andretti Green Racing right there. You can see the new nose is already on the 27 car, but great information that she did not take on new tires. Just simply a case of probably trying to get back out onto the track as quickly as possible. Now here coming in, you can see the three cars there, Dixon, and then Danica Patrick, the car on the outside, trying to get around Danica Patrick because he's probably coming in a little faster than Danica was, the 27 machine of Dario Franchitti, and he takes out the timing cone, Marty, on the way in.
And I'm sure she probably doesn't even know he's there. Take a look at it from this end.
Well, he's trying to make up time. Remember, you can go as fast as you possibly can. Up into that cone that he just hit. At the beginning of that cone, it's 60 miles an hour. She looked like she was being just a little conservative on the way in, and he's trying to make up time. Just nowhere to go.
Yeah. All right. Here is Danica coming out of pit lane, and you talked about it earlier.
Well, and with warm tires on, there again, what you're trying to do is make up some time coming out of pit lane. They leave the warm tires on because we've only got less than 20 laps left on the event. There you go.
Oh. And she just spun it and hit the wall. How did this happen? There's her father, TJ, right there in the middle of the screen.
I don't know what happened there either. We're done. You okay?
That's her sister Brooke on the right. Husband Paul Hospenball in the middle.
Well, wait for the safety crews.
And this day is over. So what looked promising has turned into a disaster.
Well, in the first one, she was right, because warm tires, you know, the team leaves those on so you can go out there and leave the pit lane faster than you would on cold. And in that situation, the car just came around on her. But Vince Welsh, you have more on Danica now?
Well, you see, as baffled as she looks, and the crew has the same look on their face. They were over the wall waiting on her to come back into the pits because she had flat spotted the tires on the way out on the initial spin. So they were going to have to put four tires back on the car. They were waiting over the wall waiting on her to come in. And they saw on the big screen here the contact that she made. They were all as baffled as she seemed to be on the radio. So definitely not finishing up the way Danica or TJ Patrick was expecting here at Kentucky.
All right, well, let's see what we have on tape. Let's go back and, well, actually, this is just the aftermath. Boy, this one's got me stymied.
It really does. We'll have to see if we get some more information on that. But she was seventh in points, and she's always talked about trying to make sure that she can continue in the points battle. And here we are with Danica on the first spin. There again, this is when she was trying to leave after the first pit stop, but just getting fuel.
Keep it going, keep it going.
And then here's the second one that we're going to look at now. She's on track. Let's listen. Oh, she got hit or something broke, guys.
Something broke.
And she almost hit the truck.
The safety car.
I have no idea what happened. Something was on the track and it distracted
me. Yeah, it sounds like she did run something over.
I wonder if we could do that one more time, guys.
Yeah, I'd love to.
And then we'll sit back and just listen with everybody. And we heard a thump, and we'll look ahead and see if we can see anything on the track. All right, before we do that, let's check in with Vince Welsh.
Kim Green, we were just listening to the onboard, and it sounded as though something may have broken on the car. Did you get any indication before that contact?
I mean, hindsight's probably 20/20. I suspect we flat-spotted the tire pretty good. You know, to be honest, I probably didn't do it. We were still showing tire pressure on all our tire pressure sensors. I probably didn't do a good job of coaching her to go slowly around until the pits opened. And so we probably popped a right rear tire, I would guess. That's the only indication we have. We don't know for sure. We didn't have a good day in the pits either. We made some mistakes there. So had a pretty fast race car, so not a good finish. And Danica did a much better job than where we ended up. And we're sorry, we probably put her in the fence, not Danica.
There you have it, Kim Green. Tough luck. Tough finding some good luck for this 7 car.
All right. Well, while all this is going on, we also point out that A.J. Foyt, the fourth, is shown in the race lead. They say that he came through the blend line before Tony Kanaan and Scott Dixon and Marco Andretti. They are second, third, and fourth. All right. Let's go back one more time to Danica's incident. Let's sit out, listen together.
Wait a minute, it will be tires only.
Yeah, probably the tire.
I think Kim Green's assessment is probably the best idea.
But you know, the luck with that whole situation, I know she's upset, but she missed the safety vehicle, which is someone's looking over for her on that one.
Well, it sounded, he said the right rear, and you can see there's not a whole lot of that tire left. So that might be the best thing that we have. And again, remember, it was flat spotted, so not the fault of the tire by any stretch of the imagination, but just didn't have enough left in it for her to get back to pit lane. So another tough break, another heartbreak for Danica Patrick. But meanwhile, as you look at the reaction of the family, it may be a big celebration for A.J. Foyt IV. He's in the lead at Kentucky. So as we continue here at Kentucky Speedway under our third caution, that's what's left of Danica Patrick's car, and we think we've pretty much been able to conclude it's that right rear. And here's another look it is. Conclusive. It just let go. The flat spot. And you're right, Scott. That could have been really wicked if she hits that safety vehicle.
And the safety vehicle is out doing a track inspection, looking for debris, and they're out there to take care of all the drivers to make sure there's nothing on the track that they would run over. But I think Kim Green's assessment was probably correct. And let's watch that right rear tire in slow motion. And she's idling around, just doing exactly what she was supposed to be doing. And the right rear tire blows. And then the car just hits the deck, hits the ground, and spins around. And watch how close that is. My goodness. Those guys in the safety car probably saw her going past backwards and just thought, where did she come from?
Yeah, they got an eye opener. All right, so let's reset this for you as we continue the cleanup process. It is A.J. Foyt IV listed in first. Tony Kanaan, Scott Dixon, Marco Andretti, Thomas Schechter, Scott Sharp, Ed Carpenter in seventh, Dario Franchitti in eighth. Let's get more on Foyt from Brianne Pettigo.
Marty, I asked Ed Curry exactly how Foyt took the lead, and he said that he and Tony Kanaan pitted around the exact same time. And when that mishap happened, leaving the pits with Danica, Foyt was able to get around Tony Kanaan. And there are huge smiles down in this pit right now, guys, as they have proclaimed, we are in P1.
Okay, we've got eight cars, as we mentioned, on the lead lap. We continue under the caution here, although it looks like we are getting ready to go back to green flag racing.
This will be some pressure for A.J. Foyt IV, there's no doubt.
Into three.
Green flag, starter, green flag.
Green is out, and here we go. That's Tony Kanaan on the high side. Ten laps to go now here at Kentucky. Can A.J. Foyt IV get his first IndyCar Series win? On the outside, here comes Tony Kanaan.
AJ's doing the right thing. He's got to stay in the low side. Keep your foot all the way down on the pedal. Looks like Kanaan's car is faster.
Still there.
Nine laps to go. And Kanaan has cleared him. So put Kanaan first, Foyt in second. Dixon is in third. You're saying, where's Franchitti? He's back in eighth. And that's how far Dario is behind as this race is quickly winding down, and Tony is checking out. So he has done everything he said he needed to do at the beginning of the broadcast. Foyt's under attack right now for second from Scott Dixon, and Dixon will gain more points if he can get around him.
Well, he certainly wants to get into second. He might not be able to catch Tony, but look at him looking on the inside right now of A.J. Foyt IV. 40 points for second, 35 for third. A difference of 5 points if he can get through, and he does.
So move Dixon to second now. Drop Foyt back to third. This would still be a career best finish for A.J. Foyt IV. Marco Andretti is quickly closing on him for position, and Thomas Schechter rounds out your top five.
AJ's got to do is try and get down the low side now and protect that bottom line and make Marco go around on the high side. It does not look like his car is very happy down hugging that white line, though, Marty. He cannot keep it down there.
Six laps to go this time by. Tony Kanaan has opened up a full 1 second lead. The largest margin of victory was the very first year the race ran here. That was 1.8 seconds.
Did you bring that up because I finished second that year?
I wasn't going to mention your name at all. The closest was a 58/1000th of a second back in 2004. Marco closing quickly now on A.J. IV. Five laps remaining here at Kentucky. That is Schechter on the outside of Andretti. That is for position as well. Meanwhile, we can tell you Dario Franchitti stays in eighth. There is Tony Kanaan with four laps remaining. The only way he loses this one, if something happens, the car is on a rail. Here comes Dario underneath Koski Matsura. That is not for position, and he can't get it done.
Remember, he had that miscue going into turn three with the front of the car. Maybe the car is not going to work as well for him either from that, or maybe he did some damage by running over the cone. They were pulling out some bodywork and parts of the wing from the under tray, so maybe the car might be off just a little bit from what he had at the beginning of the race.
Three laps remaining. It is still Tony Kanaan with a 1.3-second lead now over Dixon. And Dario stays in eighth. He is the last car on the lead lap. Castroneves is down a lap in ninth, as in Vitor Mira, Matsura, and Buddy Rice.
And Marty, that last lap, 217 and a half miles an hour for Tony Kanaan. Dixon was around 215, so Tony's got them covered right now.
Two laps to go. Take a look at Vision Racing. Three cars in the top 10. Big night for these guys. A career best for AJ the fourth, if he can hold on. Coming out of four, here comes the white flag for Tony Kanaan. He said at the beginning of the broadcast, I've got to go win. He knew he had to lead the most laps. He's done both of those. He's got to traverse this mile and a half oval one more time. Scott Dixon is going to close ground on our points leader, Dario Franchitti, as they come down the backstretch and through turns three and four. Tony Kanaan, it'll be his fourth win this year, the first to four. And is 11.
Nice job, TK. Nice job. Good job, guys. Nice job. Hey, Brooks. Happy birthday, brother. Happy birthday.
Take a look, Ellen. We have a crash at the first turn after they cross the finish line. It is Koski Matsura and Dario Franchitti. It was after the finish. Dario came across the line in eighth. Koski a lap down in 11th. You saw the close finish for second through about sixth position. It was Dixon, Foyt, Andretti, and Scheckter, followed by Sharp, Carpenter, and then Franchitti. And then after that, all hell broke loose.
Well, I'm not sure what went on with that, but we're going to have a quick replay of that so we can see. Remember, he was trying to get underneath.
Oh, my gosh. He goes up and over again?
Oh, can you count this as lucky or what in the world?
That looked like one of those hydroplane blowovers.
My goodness.
All right, here we go. We're going to go on board.
Now, you're not riding aboard a jet fighter right now when you start to see the sky.
Whoa, whoa, whoa. He just checks up and
touches the tire up and over. Reminds me of a ride in a fighter plane.
This is unreal. And there goes the onboard camera.
Oh. You know, we saw him take the steering wheel off, climbing out of the car.
There he goes, flying by that camera.
Remember, they're still doing 175 miles an hour just as soon as you get off the throttle going into that turn.
And there's Dario again climbing out. So 2 weeks in a row, he has gone airborne. Listen to the crowd. They just got the view that he's okay. All right, let's take another look.
Now, Marty, when you go past the finish line, everybody eases off the throttle and starts to slow down, as we saw from all the cars in front. I'm just not clear why Dario didn't start to slow down coming up behind Hiro Masira. Let's listen. Oh, you know something? I hate to say this. I'm not sure that he knew that was a checkered flag, because he had shifted up a gear from fifth to sixth, and I think what ended up happening is that he thought he might have had more laps to go.
Well, we'll try and get an interview with him. There is Tony Kanaan, and Vince is in victory lane. Let's go.
Well, Tony Kanaan did it again, two races in a row. You told me before the race today, I've got to win to stay in the hunt for the championship, and you did that today. At what point did you believe you had the stronger car than Dario's when the two of you were battling earlier?
Well, I was behind him. I knew we had a pretty good car, so I was trying to help him out a little bit. It was a scary moment after the race, but thank God he's okay. Special weekend for me, Vince. I didn't tell anybody, but It was my dad's birthday on Friday, so that's for you, Dad.
And TK's dad has passed, and certainly a very emotional moment for Tony Kanaan. And put it in perspective here, I know that the championship is the ultimate goal, but what does it mean to you to win that race today with that thought on your mind?
It was tough. I mean, I never cry on TV, and here you go. So, you know, it was tough. Dixon still finished second, so I didn't gain a lot of ground on him, but hey, that's all I got to do. I mean, I got to try to win a couple more races, and hopefully we'll still be in the hunt by the end of the year.
Now just 52 behind Dario. What do you see? How do you see your chances here with three to go?
It's getting closer, but still, I mean, Dario's doing a great job. I mean, unfortunately, today he didn't have a good day, but we'll see. If I can help him out, I'll help him out. If I can, we're going to try to take the championship.
You know, I might say, though, that maybe Dario did have a good day, because after seeing what he went through, maybe it was a good day after all.
For sure. I mean, twice in 2 weekends in a row, I think, I know Dario likes to fly, and he's a pretty good pilot. He flew me in here this weekend, but I'm going to tell him to stop flying with his race car right now.
Yeah, keep it in the helicopter. Tony Kanaan with the big win today.
All right, thanks, Vince. So we're going to go a little long here for all you tennis fans. That's coming up in just a matter of moments. And, of course, we've got more racing tonight at 12:30. That is a scary moment again. And, Scott, before we talk to Dario, I think your assessment may be right. The way he was in the throttle, he may not have realized the checkered flag was out. And you say, wait a minute, how can you not know that? Believe me, there's a lot of times you don't. You're just driving.
You're just going around here so fast and so often. And he heard him go up a gear when we were riding on board before. And that's what you generally do when you're going to go in a draft, like he looked like he was doing right there.
Well, we're trying to track down Dario to get a comment from him to see exactly what his thought was. As we're going to step aside for a break, it's the first time in Tony Kanaan's career he has earned back-to-back wins, and he's the first of four this year. Back here at Kentucky Speedway, where it's Tony Kanaan's first win here at Kentucky, the first ever for Andretti Green Racing. And the celebration a bit skewed again, because his teammate Dario Franchitti had a crash right after he crossed the finish line. Let's talk to the man who finished second, Scott Dixon. He's with Vince Welch.
Well, Scott, it was an eventful race. It didn't seem as though you had the car to win, but was that your strategy, just finish second if that was the best you had?
Yeah, if you can't finish first, you know, try and finish second and so on. So it was a tough day, you know, like this whole weekend. I think we had a fantastic test here, and then when we came back, man, the AGR guys seemed to have speed that nobody could even touch. And, you know, that's frustrating when you race with these guys and you're trying to get in the draft and they still pull away from you. And TK was definitely very fast. We managed to keep Dario behind us just from hugging the white line, and he didn't have enough speed to get around the top. And, you know, it was kind of their day to lose. And you know, I think they definitely messed up a lot, you know, especially with the wing that he damaged, I think, coming into the pit. So, you know, good day for us. And it's nice that it's closing the gap a little. You know, we can feel, we'll see maybe a bit of light at the end of the tunnel.
Yeah, it's almost like a win today, as Scott Dixon is now within 8 points of the series leader, Dario Franchitti. Brian Pettigo?
Well, Vince, AJ Foyt IV, you are one likable guy. I think we've seen at least one representative from nearly every single team come to congratulate you. Your best career finish ever, third. That's topping your best finish by 6 positions. What does this mean for Vision Racing? 3 cars in the top 10 today.
I think it just shows how hard we've been working. Matt Curry, my engineer, and all the other engineers with Vision Racing, obviously all of us in the top 10 today. So it's been a great weekend since we got off the truck. And just can't thank my guys enough. They did amazing pit stops and kept me up there. Wherever I came in, that's where I came out. So can't ask for any more than that. And it's just a good team effort to get me here.
Jack?
All right, Brent, good news. The one person we weren't quite sure of the condition is the first man out of the hospital, Kosuke Matsura. Give us your rendition of what happened after the checkered flag.
Well, after the checkered flag, you know, I lift off, you know. I always do, you know, after the race. And he didn't realize lift off, you know, after the race, you know. And he hit me from behind. And that was what happened. But, you know, when we get on the safety car, you know, he apologized to me, so he knew what's happening exactly, and he apologized. So, but you know, someone blamed on me, so you know that was not truth. But you know, race over, you know, crash damage, and you know, race was over. Very disappointed, you know, crash the car.
All right. Well, good news, and I can also give you the news that the good news is Dario Franchitti and his wife Ashley, they're together in the hospital, and in fact, here he comes right now. And this is a fellow that we just can't go on meeting like this. Dario, we just talked to Kosuke, and he said that you apologized to him. What was the situation?
Yeah, that one was completely my fault. There's no excuse for it. I screwed up twice in the race. I screwed up once coming in the pits, and then, after the checker, Kosuke lifted. I didn't realize it was the checker. I got the, hey, it's the checker, just as I was hitting him. So, it's not his fault at all. I'm pretty disgusted myself right now for that, for both my mistakes today. And again, that could have been a big one. So, glad I'm okay. But, really upset with myself right now.
Well, we'll let you and your wife go and have a private moment. Fellas.
All right, thanks, Jay. And you got to remember, he was not really racing with anybody on the track. You're saying, how can he forget? Well, Kosuke was lap traffic. He and the guy behind him wasn't battling for position at that point either. And you sort of lose track of time because you're just doing lap after lap. All right, let's go back. If you take one more look at his car, let's go back to last week. And you want to talk about one lucky guy? Look at this, 2 weeks in a row.
Two cars, Dan Weldon's car and Franchitti's car, touches, comes down, lands on top of Scott Dixon's car, who was in the championship chase with him. And here today, just going over the finish line. You can see the speed of the car still going by after the finish line, Marty. Like I said, still probably 175 miles an hour. If that's not lucky, I don't know what is.
He's done more flips than a gymnast in the last 2 weeks. All right, let's take a look at the results here at Kentucky Speedway. And you can see, we mentioned that A.J. Foyt IV gets his career best third. Marco Andretti with a fourth place run. As you can see, eight cars finish on the lead lap. A good run for Vision Racing. As you can see, they've got three cars right up there. And you can see the cars that are a lap down through 12th place to Buddy Rice. And then there's Darren Manning, Sarah Fisher. They're even further back. Ryan Hunter-Reay, and then the three cars, Danica Patrick, Dan Weldon, and Sam Cornish. And they are working on the safer barrier. And the reason they're working on it is because, well, the Indy Pro Series is going to run in a matter of moments. There are the points. It's down to eight between Franchitti and Dixon. 52 back to Kanaan. All but the top five are mathematically eliminated. But right now, folks, realistically, it's a three-car race. So that's going to wrap it up for us here at Kentucky Speedway. So we'll see you Sunday, August 26th at 3:30 Eastern on ESPN for the Optima Batteries IndyCar Grand Prix of Sonoma. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. Drag racing tonight coming up at 12:30, and then again at 7 o'clock tomorrow in the evening on ESPN2. Coming up next, it's the 2007 U.S. Open Series Tennis. Congratulations once again to Tony Kanaan. For our entire ESPN crew, I'm Marty Reed. Till we meet again.